I've used DaVinci Resolve for over 10 years, but it seems like every week, I'm still learning something new. Like hitting the dropdown that's right next to the search button, it's kind of hidden. That way you can search the entire project by file name to find a matching clip or timeline.
So by default, if you just type in Julia and it's set to selected bins, you're gonna get nothing. So choose all bins and you can find everything in your project.
Or there's this little trick to close up all of your expanded bins by holding down the Option key on a Mac or Alt on a PC while clicking on the master bin. Nice, right? Well, in just a few minutes, I'm gonna show you some of the lesser known tricks that I use all the time, and hopefully you're gonna find them useful too. Lasso Trim. I'm calling this the normal edit mode Lasso Trim. Now, anytime that you wanna make a quick edge selection of a clip with a mouse or a Wacom pen. Now, most editors, and I'm saying this because this was me just until recently, you hit T, shortcut key, that enters trim mode, or you can hit this button, and then drag to make a selection over the edge of the clip to trim it up. However, instead of changing to trim edit mode, you can actually stay in normal edit mode and simply hold down Option or Alt with Shift, and then lasso drag the selection with your mouse. So bookmark that one. It's the Option, Shift, mouse drag for selecting the edges of clips. Oh, and before you remind me that I can use V to select the nearest edit point with the keyboard shortcut, yeah, that works. But what if you have a whole stack of clips with some graphic layers that all need to be trimmed together? This is when the normal edit mode lasso trim really shines. Place on top with the timeline overlay. There's a trick to place on top that maybe you've never used before. And if you're an experienced editor, you might prefer to cut with precision into your timeline using the three-point edit. But how do you do that with a generator, an adjustment clip, or a title? Well, first you mark your timeline with an in and out point. That's I and O on the keyboard, or if you're a left-hand driven keyboard editor, I use E and R, but that's a tutorial for another day. Anyways, drag to the overlay that says place on top, and bam, you have placed the effects generator onto the timeline and constrained it to the in and out marks, like a three-point edit. And the reason that I like to highlight place on top is that it removes the complexities of patching your destination to the specific track, which is what these important orange boxes do. Place on top does what it says it does. It's a lot like the Connect Edit feature that's in Final Cut Pro, where there's no track patching at all. Now, as a bonus tip, if you mostly use this new drag and drop trick with place on top, you can set this up as a default in user editing settings with the checkbox for timeline overlay retains the last performed actions. You don't have to drag it to the specifically small far right overlay box. Oh, and place on top is also great to work directly from the media pool to spot new audio tracks or mixes down to your timeline without dragging to the overlay function, because anything from the media pool can be edited with the shortcut F12. It creates new timeline tracks as needed, so that's super useful too. You just gotta make sure that you have an orange destination box selected, not turned off, because for some reason, this is required to edit from the media pool. And it's also true for force conforming, but that's a topic for another day. The index panel has several uses, but as a follow-up to the place on top tip, is this faster way to fix audio track mapping on the edit page. So ideally, stereo audio gets placed onto stereo tracks, indicated with a number 2 for two channels of sound, and mono audio goes to mono tracks, but we know this isn't always the case. Stuff happens, right? And for me, when I use place on top, it likes to create stereo tracks. So if I'm dropping a mono voiceover track or a 5.1 mix down, which is something I do a lot, they're incorrectly assigned to stereo. To change this, you would right-click on the tiny little 2.0 area and change the track type to mono, and you'd have to do this one at a time. That's no fun. So a faster way is to open the index and then go to the Tracks tab. Here, you can reorder the tracks, which are gonna be reflected on the timeline, but you can also shift-select the tracks to change them all to mono at once. See? It's the little things that make a difference. But now, it's your turn. Down in the comments, I want to learn your favorite little DaVinci Resolve tips. Don't worry, this tutorial is just part one of these little things you need to know. There's more next week. And because there's so much more to learn, I'll see you in the next video.